What if I told you that a natural compound made by your gut from foods like raspberries, walnuts, and even a specific type of bacon could boost your strength, endurance, and cellular health? Okay, I'm being a bit sensational, I'll admit, but forgive me, I'm excited because there's legitimate science here you won't want to miss on a compound called Urolithin A that's making waves in the science and metabolism world. At a high level, Urolithin A is a gut microbe-derived natural metabolite made from complex polyphenols in foods called elagitannins. And in the last 5 years alone, there have been over 500 studies, peer-reviewed and published, that have explored Urolithin A's impact on everything from exercise performance and muscle strength to inflammation and brain health. Don't worry, I'm not going to subject you to a breakdown of all 500 in this video. Instead, we'll dive into one of the most compelling human randomized controlled trials, in my opinion, published in Cell Reports Medicine, which tested Urolithin A's effects on muscle strength and endurance and mitochondrial health. And if you're wondering how to get more Urolithin A naturally from your diet, and what the deal is with pomegranate and special bacon, we're going to cover that too. Anyway, on to the study. This study enrolled 88 overweight adults. The mean BMI was 29 kilograms per meter squared, who were between the ages of 40 and 64. They were enrolled for a 4-month intervention where they were treated with one of two different doses of Urolithin A, either 500 milligrams or 1,000 milligrams per day, or treated with a placebo control. And strikingly, both doses of Urolithin A, the 500 and the 1,000 milligrams, improved leg muscle strength by 10 to 12% as compared to baseline and improved leg muscle strength as compared to the placebo. Now, as a quick statistical aside, for randomized controlled trials like this, you typically want to compare the intervention, or interventions in this case, to the control group, the placebo. That's considered a more appropriate analysis than the change from baseline, since if the placebo control group also improves, you might suspect other factors other than the intervention, for example, the Urolithin A, is responsible for the change. But in this case, I want to point out, the placebo group actually got weaker over the 4-month period. So I suppose it's extra striking that the two Urolithin A groups both improved in terms of leg muscle strength. Now, in the study, they also tested hand grip strength, and although the changes didn't reach statistical significance, the higher dose of Urolithin A was trending positively, with about a 5% improvement in hand grip strength, which is nothing to sneeze at. So this might be a case of the study just not being powered enough to detect this outcome, i.e. there weren't enough participants, but that could be clarified by future studies. Anyway, moving on, in terms of endurance performance, peak power output similarly trended upward in the Urolithin A groups by about 4% from baseline, with no change from baseline in the placebo group. Along with that, there were increases from baseline in peak VO2 in the 1,000 milligram dose of Urolithin A, and improvements in cycling distance and a walking test that passed the threshold of what's considered clinically significant, which means it was a pretty large effect size, enough to be meaningful in a clinical setting. All this is to say, in this randomized placebo-controlled trial, in just 4 months, Urolithin A, dosed at 500 milligrams and 1,000 milligrams per day, showed improvements in strength at both doses, with improvements in endurance performance at the 1,000 milligram dose. Hopefully that makes sense. That's the high-level summary. Now, how do the metabolic changes stack up to these functional changes? Well, the researchers observed decreases in something called acylcarnitines. Don't freak out, I know it's a big word. Basically, this metabolic change suggests increased fat burning, beta oxidation, by mitochondria. And they also noted decreased inflammation, as measured by C-reactive protein, CRP, and a cytokine panel. Here are the data. I won't pretend these data strike me with complete shock and awe. However, I can see a clear signal and personally consider this a meaningful finding. Additionally, they measured levels and markers of proteins related to mitophagy, mitochondrial autophagy, which is the process by which old, damaged mitochondria are basically removed so the mitochondrial pool can be renewed. Mitophagy is really important for maintaining muscle and organ health. And interestingly, the researchers found increases in components of what's called the Parkin system, which regulates mitophagy. But peculiarly, these increases occurred only at the 500 milligram dose. It's a bit hard to interpret these data in isolation. And being straight with you, this is just sometimes how the data turn out. I'm being transparent. Science can be messy. However, taken in the context of other data, I'm placing my personal bet that Urolithin A does increase mitophagy in humans, and that this explains, at least in part, the functional muscular benefits that were observed in this randomized controlled trial. Of note, the Urolithin A treatment in this study also increased levels of key components in the mitochondrial electron transport chain and overall mitochondrial content. So if you were to ask me if I'm impressed, I'd say, honestly, yeah, I am impressed. Again, as a high-level summary, in just 4 months in this randomized placebo-controlled trial, Urolithin A tended to improve strength and endurance performance, as well as inflammation and suggestions of improved mitochondrial health. Now, to quickly list some of the limitations of this study. The adults included were overweight and generally sedentary. It's not clear that these benefits would generalize to metabolically fit active individuals. I think it's fair to say one would expect a bigger effect size from Urolithin A supplementation in more metabolically impaired individuals. I could be wrong, but that's my guess, that people who are older, sedentary, and have metabolic dysfunction would benefit more from Urolithin A supplementation. On the other hand, it's possible that over a longer time course, longer than 4 months, more positive results would manifest that we didn't get to see in this study. And larger trials with more statistical power conducted in the future will likely reveal further significant results and benefits for Urolithin A. That's my prediction. Now, where can you get ellagitannins, the precursors to Urolithin A, from foods? Well, I mentioned pomegranates, particularly the white portion, not the pink portion, and most people throw away the white portion. Also berries, especially yellow raspberries, and walnuts in green and black teas. Also, and here's a fun fact, Iberian pigs in Spain eat acorns rich in ellagitannins, leading to higher levels of Urolithin A in their meat. I'll be honest, I heard this bit of information from about 1 hour and 1 minute into a STEM Talks podcast with the first author of the study we just reviewed. Although I was having trouble verifying this fact in the peer-reviewed literature, I generally try to verify facts, but this might be because that this special ham and the concentrations of Urolithin A within it were never formally published and it's insider information. But honestly, I'm still down to eat this special Iberian pork bacon and maybe even just reap the rewards of a pork SIBO. It's also notable that there's a lot of variability in individual humans' abilities to transform dietary ellagitannins into urolithins. It's actually a quite complex process. But it's generally thought that the healthier your microbiome, the more likely you will have the capacity to turn the ellagitannins in your pomegranate, walnuts, green and black teas, what have you, into urolithins. Now, those who don't convert ellagitannins to urolithins basically at all, they're called metabotype zero, which is basically a fancy way of saying your microbes are slacking on your leg day. However, the good news is there's some suggestion that with more exposure to ellagitannins, say eating more walnuts over time, those metabotype zero individuals, the non-converters, may acquire the ability to make urolithins as their microbiome adapts. Here's to hoping. Also, it's worth raising the possibility that other gut health promoting behaviors, like eating fermented foods, can alter the microbiome in a manner that facilitates Urolithin A production. And interestingly, the French, who eat a whole lot of fermented dairy as a population have particularly high rates of Urolithin A producers as a population, about 2.5 times as much as that of Canadians. I'm sorry. Kind of sucks, eh? My favorite fermented French cheese, personally, without question, is Roquefort. It's my dietary Achilles heel. The cheese of love, as well, if you know anything about the history of Roquefort. So, it fits with my confirmation bias to believe that a combination of Roquefort, walnuts, and Iberian bacon is a superstar trio for gut health and metabolic health. I'm gonna run with that narrative for now. Nobody correct me. Now, wrapping up, if all this information on Urolithin A is interesting to you, I'm gonna drop two recommended podcasts with the first author, one on STEM Talk and one on Metabolic Link. Two podcasts I've been on myself, and I must say, the hosts are great. This is a great conversation, or these are great conversations, and I'll link them below. And as a final reflection, these data, they remind me that real, lasting gains, muscular gains, happen at the cellular level. That's an important truth. And if you found this breakdown very helpful, flex that finger and hit the subscribe button. The mitochondria might be the powerhouse of the cell, but you're the powerhouse of this channel. Hope that wasn't too cheesy for you. Stay curious. I'll see you in the next one.